Meeting to order, and we have one addition to our agenda, a Conservation Commission warrant number 4 was inadvertently left off the section for bills for payment, just an oversight, so we're going to add that when we come to there, warrant number 4. But our first order of business would be to review and approve the minutes of November 25th and December 3rd.
I would move approval of the select board meeting, the minutes of the select board meeting November 25th and the budget meeting on December 3rd.
I second that motion.
Okay, is there any discussion? All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Of the 25th, aye. Wasn't here for the third, so.
Okay. So then moving on to bills for payment, we have warrant 12P, we have Recreation Board number 6, and then the Conservation Commission's warrant number 4.
Could I request number 4 be done separately, because I reviewed them earlier and didn't see it?
It was in there. It was just left off the agenda.
Oh, I'm sorry. Then I did see it. Okay. Oh, yes, I did. Okay. Thank you, Lori. Yeah. Thanks for correcting me.
Hi.
Hi. How are you?
Good. Your seats are
right
over there.
Have a seat.
Thank you.
Let's see. So,
I move we approve Conservation Commission number 4, warrant number 12P, and Rec Board number 6.
I'd second that.
Okay. Any discussion? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
All right. Then we have our state, one of our state representatives here, one a fellow who needs no introduction from me. And Mike, would you like to step up to the table?
And sure. Thanks, Joe.
All that practice. Can you leave it at that?
Let me try.
Yes,
Michael Rowitsky. Is that right?
Rowitsky.
Yes, all right.
Rowitsky.
Or and some people know you. Yes.
Thanks a lot for the chance to come and hear what's happening on the ground level here for you. Hopefully, you don't have anything for me as such as Westminster does.
No, actually.
You're looking for a bridge?
What I was wanted to know would be, as you get ready to go back to the legislature, the last time we spoke to you, you kind of were, the school funding issues weren't your strongest suit. You had some, maybe you were on the learning curve for that, and I'm wondering what you've learned, what you anticipate, what you're going to do for us as far as the education. You know, we're here with our municipal budget, you know, debating over $30 expenditures. We have committees that we are having, you know, they're actually having bake sales and tag sales to get funding. It's because we're so constrained. The school portion of the town's budget is taking up so much. We've feel here, at least speaking for myself, we have to hold the line on municipal spending to the extent where we're not undertaking new projects or improvements. And how are you going to help us on this? Mm-hmm. That's what I'd like to know.
Well, I wish I could wave a magic wand, but I don't know where that is right now. I think in regards to spending, we just got through an election where right across the board, education spending was the issue that resonated most across the state. And I have to say, surprisingly, I've heard more about that in the three towns I represent than I have before. in the previous 8 years, and that may be Santa Claus we hear coming to visit. And when you say you're looking for help, I'm not quite sure. Are you looking for increased funding from the state for help in... I think we're trying to, in some places, define the problem because it gets ping-pong back and forth, whereas schools are saying we're doing all we can. From the governor's office, what he's saying is we're seeing diminished school populations, so why is it costs continuing to rise at the rate they are? And I think somewhere in between there, we've got to find a solution to this. And I think there's going to be a lot of suggestions this year as to what we can do. I have a feeling that there's going to have to be a little bit of everything, that people are going to have to realize perhaps spending is a piece of that. I know the speaker has talked about looking at spending in terms of student to staff ratios. I think we have some of the lowest ratios, which on some level might be seen as good, but at what level can we afford that as well? I think Dummerston has traditionally supported education very strongly, even with one of the higher per pupil spending rates in the state. But I have to say, I don't know if you're hearing the same thing I'm hearing from people in Dummerston and Putney and Westminster, but I've heard from more people in Dummerston this year about taxes, property taxes, than I have before. I was supposed to meet with the school board yesterday, but we got snowed out. Hopefully I can meet, we're scheduled to meet. On the immediate horizon, I don't know that there's any relief. I think the statewide property tax, the numbers that were sent out, I think they're looking at a 2%. Is that what you got?
A 2 cent
increase.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I know over the previous 2 years, I think we totaled a 9 cent increase, which was probably higher than the previous 10 years. And I think there's something to what the governor says. That rate gets set based on the spending statewide. And I think Dummerston, Putney, and Westminster were all caught in that dilemma of they held spending to a pretty much a minimum increase, but it generated, I think a 2% increase generated a 25% increase in taxes. So one of the things I hope we're going to do is look at the formula on the state level as to why that translates the way it has. And I'm not sure what your school's numbers are this year, but I know in Putney last year we lost a number of students, so that's why we had a similar 1% increase in spending, but about a 20% increase in the tax rate. This year, Putney's up, so it'll be interesting to see how that'll affect money they draw down from the state. I don't know if you're aware of what the numbers are over at the Dummerston School this year.
Not for this current year, but for the 2013-14 school year, it was 165, which was the same as the year previous.
So on the state side, I think that's one thing we need to do is look at the formula. I think what some people are suggesting is we look at spreading how schools get funded a little wider and not rely exclusively on the property tax the way it is. I think one of the difficulties a lot of people have, it is hard to understand how that formula works and how that translates into what your property tax bill is going to be. So
I know that was one of the school board's questions last year at the town meeting, was could somebody explain that formula? And I think at some point somebody's going to be able to explain that formula. And everybody says, somebody's got to explain that pretty soon.
We'll here's what I can do, and I've talked about this in Putney already. We have people who are on the Ways and Means Committee and people who work the staff who are ready to come out to the towns and sit down with people and explain that. I think it's from town to town it's a little different, but basically you know, the factors that come into that formula should be set before town meeting, and if that's something you folks would like, I can set that up.
I would think, I shouldn't speak for the school board, but I know much of their discussion, even at town meeting, was that they would like that explained to them. Right. And they'd asked and just hadn't got the answer. So it sounds like at least the answer's available. Yeah.
Well, I mean, Jim Kane should have been one, and I forget the new guy's name.
Frank?
Yeah. I mean, if he doesn't understand it, because he's where the rubber meets the road. So that's something we can do, is get somebody in the tax department down here to explain how that formula works. So in regards to that, maybe a bridge would have been easier.
Yeah. I think we can understand it maybe a little better.
Current use, where is that?
Yeah.
What do you see as far as funding, and where is that going?
Well, I hope it doesn't go anywhere. I know I've, again, heard from some people in town who I think don't understand current use and look at that as a target, as to, isn't that a place we can save? And you know, I've been playing basketball with Jack Mannix for about 30 years now, and I think Jack explains it as well as anyone, that that's money pretty well spent. We could take properties out of current use and let people put up a 50 house development, and then my guess is people would squawk that we're filling up the schools now and we have all these other services to provide. I support current use. I think it's a great way to protect the working landscape. There's a broad base of uses, and I think that's what some people don't understand. What I've heard concerns about are people who just keep their land forested, but the reality is people have to spend a good deal of money to put together a land management plan before they can be eligible for that.
Right.
So it's not a trip to the candy store for them, and they have to abide by that too. One of the things we have thought about, and this, I don't think this happens around here as much as this has happened up in northern Vermont with some large parcels of land, is there are some developers who have done what they call parking some land, where they buy a significant piece of land and really they're just waiting for the prices right so they can sell it off to developing. We don't think that's what current use was set up for. That's the kind of thing I think we want to take a look at and make sure it doesn't happen. But as far as current use, I don't see if there's any proposed changes for it.
We're always worried about the funding for it.
Yep. But I think that's going to be steady on, and I know that there's certainly in our delegation, you know, we have Carolyn Partridge, who chairs the Agriculture Committee, and that's a really important piece for her, and I know David Kizis and others. I think we've got a good mix of land in Vermont, and our working landscape is working. We want to continue it that way, and so I don't see any problems with that.
Mike, there's been some things in the paper about single payer coming up, and they're talking about, I guess, an 8% payroll tax.
I don't know who's talking about that.
What's been in the paper?
There's been a lot in the paper. It didn't come out of the governor's office, though.
Okay.
So, but I'm sorry.
That's fine. Yeah. I mean, I'm relieved if indeed that's not going to be necessarily the case.
Yeah.
I guess my question is just, you know, what would that do to, you know, folks considering moving in from out of state, for instance.
Well, it's interesting you say that. We've been hearing a lot about people leaving Vermont, and I guess we just got some data that in the last 5 years we've had more people move into Vermont than leave Vermont. And I think people are pretty cognizant of the political landscape here in Vermont. We've also heard from doctors that would like to move here if we pass single payer, because they're tired of having to hire staff just to deal with insurance. I'm not sure how the funding scheme is going to work out. I think there's going to be part of a payroll tax. I don't know where that is, but the money is there. We already spend all we need, and hopefully we can start spending less on health care. How we shift it from premiums to direct payments is going to be the sticking point. The conditions that prompted this move towards the exchange and just single payer are still there. People have been paying more and more for less and less coverage. And a lot of us feel that in the long run, we're going to save money if people have access without high deductibles that they don't use. I was at a meeting of the Brattleboro Hospital Board a couple years ago, and they were noting that their use was down, income was down a little bit, and their CFO said people are using it less, they're also shopping. And at that point, a board member said, yeah, I want to know why. We went up to St. Johnsbury for a procedure for my husband because it was thousands of dollars less there than in Brattleboro. So these are the kinds of things I think we want to try and level that playing field. One of the challenges is going to be for employers that don't offer health care now or haven't been, they're going to feel harder hit than people who have been. Some of us feel that's going to level the playing field because we've found with state contracts and other things that sometimes people could lowball a contract, and then we find out, well, they pay less, they don't offer as much to their employees, and that's why there has been a push for some uniformity in how that goes to level the playing field. But there's definitely going to be some more rocky roads ahead. One of the good news to come out of this right now is the online exchange that we have seems to be working a lot better than anything we've had in the past. I don't know if anyone here has had any trouble with getting back on, but I know I've been hearing a lot less complaints or requests for help than I have in the past. So we'll see how that goes. It's definitely, I think there are three big things on our plate as we go in. The budget, we're looking at having to make up a projected shortfall, but at the end of every year we balance the budget. The shortfall is about 1% of the budget, so out of a $5 billion budget, I think we're looking at perhaps $100 million. Now, if there's going to be cuts to do that, they're going to hurt, whether it's $5 or $5 million, or $5 million, cuts are going to hurt. But, what we're going to try and do is look and see what's working, what's not working. But one of the things we've taken on over the last few years is something that originated in the Agency of Human Services about 20 years ago when Con Hogan was there, and it's results-based accountability, RBA way of doing business, which basically says you have to say what you're going to do before you get money, and then we're going to look and see if that's what, in fact, you did. A lot of funding, and similarly in the medical field, a lot of funding goes out just for showing up. Like you could say, I saw five people today, and then you want to get paid for five people. What we're asking next is, so what were the results of the visits with the five people that you saw? And this has been used in the Agency of Human Services. I mean, Con Hogan literally wrote the book about it. He's been a consultant now around the country, and actually in Ireland, too. They brought him over there. This is going to be used in all departments, we're looking at how the money is actually being spent, and that will help guide some of these decisions, these tough decisions we have to make to balance the budget. But we will balance the budget, so that's probably one of the first things we have to deal with when we get in. Second one's going to be healthcare, and then the third one's going to be education achievements and spending. And one of the things I'm concerned about is that we don't lose sight of the fact that you know, our schools are doing pretty well in a lot of areas. Dummerston does good, you know, they've got good scores here. Most schools do well for most students. Where the achievement gap is when we get into different economic demographics, and that's where I think we need to continue to focus and try and close that achievement gap. So that's kind of a two-pronged process for how we want to look at education, make sure that we maintain the achievement of Vermont kids. Higher than that, I can't say what's going to happen with higher education. I traveled down to New Jersey to see my mother over the weekend, was listening to different radio, and I heard a broadcast, and this professor from NYU said that he sees an incredible sea change at that level, only because the costs of college education now are the increases are so far beyond what rates of inflation are, and they're also having declining student populations that he sees a lot of colleges not going to be able to make it. That right alongside that, you've got more and more students who are wondering, is the level of debt that I have to incur to go to college now worth it? It's a problematic concern that people have to face, and that may impact, you know, in the big picture, what happens with schools. This guy suggested, you know, Google University is going to be the place most people go. They're putting together classes now, getting the best and the brightest across the spectrum, and people are lining up from here to the border to sign up for their classes. And as opposed to kids going to big schools like BU, sitting in a class with 200 people being taught by a teaching assistant and paying $50,000 a year for that. So at that level, nothing we can do, but it'll be interesting to see how that sugars off. I'd also heard from a number of people in town about a safety concern, and I'm sure you're aware of it, and I've been talking with people at the church and with the sheriff's department. I think people seem to be calming down a little bit, but I think there's still a concern, and just want to let you know I've been trying to work on that. I've been talking with people, I've been talking with the sheriff, with the state police, and with the Department of Mental Health, so hopefully that situation will stay. But I do want to let you know that if something comes up, please feel free to call me. I know that Reverend Griffin has been in touch with me frequently about this, and certainly an unfortunate situation, but it's something that I'm glad to try and open doors for. People have concerns.
I just had one more comment, and I know Zeke's got a full agenda tonight. Several people waiting here to get on the agenda, but I just, from a small business perspective in Vermont, there's a lot of small businesses that have 2, 3, and 4 employees, and health insurance, providing health insurance, or whether it's another tax or whatever, can be crippling, because they don't have a way to recoup that income easily. And I just hope that we think about the small businesses as well as being able to provide the health care. It can be crippling to them. There's a lot of 2, 3, and 4 small businesses.
I think 70% of Vermont businesses are under 10 employees.
And you just cannot recoup huge surcharges.
I know the governor's aware of that because he has a small business like that, and we need to account for that as we try and move forward. But you're right; it's a big concern.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
No, it looks like we got a lot of people on the agenda. We got to keep moving.
So just to look ahead, would you want, before town meeting, me to try and get somebody down here to...
How about we...
I think if you work through the school board, and we might be able to be invited to that. I shouldn't speak for the school board, but I do know at town meeting that was a concern. And I'm thinking of Dan Normando's comment.
Maybe if they took the lead on it.
Right.
Okay, well, I'm going to be meeting with them next week, so...
I guess I was more supporting their position of trying to figure this out.
Great.
Although I would like to understand it as well.
Yeah, yeah, that must be very important for you.
Okay.
Good. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Well, feel free to be in touch. You can email me as we have. You also can call the number still 387-8787.
Okay.
All right. Operators are standing by to take your call. And thank you for your work. I mean, you guys meet probably a lot more than we do over the course of the year, but it's great to see you.
Zeke's a slave driver.
Yeah.
Right. All right. Well, thank Mike, thanks.
Thank you. Okay. So we have a letter from Mrs. Franklin inviting us to a meeting, and we have, that was last Wednesday, we were already having our own meeting, so we invited
you
here.
About the meeting here.
Yeah.
I'm here. I'm sitting in the corner.
So, and then we invited our representatives to the Wyndham Solid Waste District here also. So, Mrs. Franklin, do you want to
start? Not really.
I think.
But I will.
Okay.
Going forward, as everyone knows about Act 148 with the new solid waste law, next year starts July 1st. There are many changes that the public is going to have to make, as well as haulers and possibly the district, the solid waste district as well. And I've had several people contact me saying they were concerned over some of the decisions the district has been making and they wanted to know more information. I had been sharing it with my town of Guilford, and the administrative assistant, who's no longer there, she wanted a workshop, so she got things rolling, and then she left, so here we are. But some of the main concerns are single stream versus dual stream, and the need for the 24/7 boxes in the towns once Act 148 is in effect next July. Those are big ticket items on the budget, and it could save, you know, a fair amount of money for the assessments for the 19 member towns. As of next July 1st, if you are a hauler, you have to supply, if your customer wants, recycling. And if you haul your own, if you don't hire someone, then wherever you bring your trash, they have to accept the recyclables as well. So it seems to us the bins are like a duplication of service that are, they might be convenient, but they're not necessary at a cost of servicing them of over $200,000 a year. And that's one concern. The other is the dual stream versus single stream. Most haulers, as you can imagine, like single stream because of the ease of picking it up. But that's not the main concern, whether the district should be dual or single stream, because we can take our single stream recyclables elsewhere. We're already doing it. The concern is that it would possibly save the district money if they went to single stream. And those are our concerns, and Guilford just wanted to get all the towns talking together and looking. There's a budget meeting tomorrow night at the district, and that budget is based on dual stream and keeping the boxes out for 6 months after July 1st.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any idea how, you know, because there are lots of different haulers that work in Dummerston,
mm-hmm.
Do you have any idea how many households are serviced by haulers rather than dealing with it themselves?
No.
Yeah, okay.
I don't know what the ratio is.
That was a wild guess on mine.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Do you, Tim?
No.
There is.
It's hard to tell. There's several people in town. And
yeah.
I mean, how many households do you have in town?
Oh, 700 or 650
something.
Yeah.
So they probably tell you how many register with them or buy a sticker with the district, and then you could figure that out.
So the haulers, when this new law takes effect, will they, do they have to take their recyclables to Wyndham Solid Waste?
No.
Or can they take it any place?
No, we can take it anywhere we want.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Has there been any work with the haulers? I've been trying to get to the energy committee or somebody to discuss, because quite often I'll see like three different haulers on our road.
Mm-hmm.
Has there been any work between the haulers to try to consolidate routes or work together so that you're not all traveling on the same roads, picking up different houses, anything like that?
To some degree,
okay.
You try to service certain areas. However, you want the competition too to keep the prices down. You know, if you get a monopoly in one area.
Yeah, I wouldn't suggest one hauler
right.
for the whole town.
Right.
It just seems foolish. For it's like school buses, like five school
right.
buses go by.
No,
I'm thinking
hear, yeah.
maybe
mm-hmm.
this could be more efficient. But
So you suggested single stream.
Right.
For Wyndham Solid Waste to do single stream rather than dual stream. And,
right.
And that would save them money. How would that save them money?
Yes. Well, with the single stream, you don't have the materials recycling facility running, so you would shut that whole part of the district down, which would save, I don't know the figures, but it would save money there. You don't get as much for the product because it's all mixed, and it's. But I believe that the expenses saved outweigh the revenue that you get with the dual stream. The other thing is that the MRF is, I don't know how old, 25 years old, and it's how, you know, how long do you want to keep putting money into a machine that is that old? I did an analysis.
The MRF is the sorting.
Yes, the processor.
Conveyors and bales,
yeah. I did a cost expense for 1 year for the MRF, and it was just under $80,000 to keep it going. So, I mean, after a while, you have to get rid of your old car, you know. And I did looked at the check register for this current month, and obviously there was one large equipment repair for the glass crusher, which obviously wouldn't happen every month. But the MRF this month was $3,512 to keep it going. The other thing I noticed on this check register was that we pay for glass disposal because there's no value in glass. And if you do single stream, you wouldn't have to pay for getting rid of the glass that you take in because it all goes together.
So could you just explain to somebody like myself that isn't up on all of this?
Uh-huh.
I mean, when you talk about single stream, and what's the difference in how the things are handled and where they're going?
Single stream for the household, they put all their recyclables, it's all the same recyclables, into one bin versus having to separate your cardboard from your plastic and whatever. And if you did that, then it's all just brought in one truck, loaded into a tractor trailer, and they ship it out. And it probably, I believe, Brattleboro Salvage takes theirs now to Rutland's facility. It's run there, single stream. The dual stream gets processed here locally, and we pull out all the things that are trash, you know, to make it a better product. And then you look for commodities, which are always up and down, for the best prices that you can get for each market.
Thank you.
You said it cost $80,000 last year to for upkeep of that machine?
Just under.
Mm-hmm. And do you guys have the number? Which
yeah, I can give you some sheets that help you. I'm a supervisor from Jamaica, and I've been elected chair of the board, so I'm the chair of the board of supervisors.
I invited Lou here this evening along with Bob Spencer, our executive director, in the event that, although I was also an invitee to listen to Cheryl, you had any questions that I wasn't prepared to answer, I thought, well, you know, we'll just put all the heads together.
Anyways, I've
got one question right off the bat. I've been looking over your budget. Back 5 years ago, when the waste district was in a real financial bind, I, being the new guy on the select board, I was chosen to attend meetings, and there are quite a few meetings over a 6 or 7 month period. And there was a different director at the time.
Yes, George Murray.
George Murray. But when I've been going down the budget, I have a copy of the budget. I don't mean to, let's see, you should never ask someone about, you know, money or something, but we are in a different position here. Are you the executive director or the manager or?
I'm executive director.
Okay. And is,
I'm Bob Spencer, by the way.
It's a part-time position?
Yes.
And what's your salary
in
the budget?
About 45.
My mother's
salary has gone up
2%.
No, it's about $47,000.
$47,000. Okay. So it's not as high as it was under the previous.
Under the previous director, he was a contractor.
Okay.
So, in fact, the IRS ruled that that position should not be a contractor, and in fact charged the district back FICA taxes.
Okay.
So, unfortunately, it's hard to compare apples to apples because he was paid as if he was a 1099, whereas Bob is a...
All right.
So. But it was about the same. It was approximately the same.
Okay. All right. And you had another question you were answering for us, right?
Yeah. Charlotte brought up single stream versus dual stream, and I've been doing some analysis now. It's very hard to do analysis forward projecting because we have no clue what Act 148 is going to do to the tonnages of recycling we're going to get or whatever. But what I did was I put together a worksheet that was based on the previous fiscal year and what would our end game would have looked like if we'd have been single stream as if instead of being dual stream. So what I'm going to do is to pass out to you. Well, I wouldn't mind holding that. This is a comparison based on last year's numbers of dual stream, which are based on actuals, and single stream, which is based on the same number of tonnage, based on the contract that the RFP was put out for single stream and for dual stream. Now,
Lou, why don't you explain the RFP? That's a big...
Yeah, what we did about 3 or 4 months ago was we wanted to be able to compare single stream versus dual stream, and we were given some numbers from Casella, but they were estimates basically. So we put out an RFP to ask anybody who's interested on what they would charge us for single stream recycling. We got 3 responses. One from Waste Management, which was so much higher than the rest, we aren't even considering it. And the other 2 are Triple T and TAM. TAM is a company in
Shasbury,
just north of Bennington. And Triple T, you probably are familiar with them. They're in Brattleboro. The interesting thing about the 2 proposals, before we get to the actual numbers, is that Triple T would do the work in their facility, which would free up our facility to be used for something else, like composting or whatever. Whereas TAM's proposal was to use our facility as a transfer station, and then they would send trucks to our facility and bring the materials to their facility in I think it's Pollitt or
Pommel.
Will be there where their facility is. So there's even though the bottom line numbers aren't one is significantly lower than the other. The other, the one that's higher would free up our building for something else. So there's a value to that that's hard to quantify. So what you'll notice as you look through this budget. What you'll notice here is that these are the expenses for our processing of dual stream in that column. You'll notice a lot of those expenses are blank on these 2 columns because we wouldn't need those services. Just as an aside, so you know it, if we did go single stream, we'd probably have to lay off about 8 people. So that's why you see the salaries and benefits part of this very negligible in single stream versus dual stream. But that's one thing to consider that we would have to do if we did go single stream. In addition, there are other places in the budget where there's a slight impact, perhaps, because we have to add, we have to keep a person to run the yard, the convenience center, and the like. But basically, the differences are up in the top part, which is the MRF processing, and the bottom line number at the very end of the budget. However, what you should be aware of, that there's a lot of variables. And right now, the market is very low. If the market were ever to go up again, our dual stream would be able to reap the benefits of that, whereas the single stream would not, because it's a pretty consistent cost that we would have to pay. So part of the idea of staying with dual stream might be that when the markets do get better, we'd be able to reap the benefits. In fact, 3 or 4 years ago, we were able to put $125,000 profits that we had in excess of the budget towards future budgets. So when the market is good, we can be about $125,000 or $150,000 to the good. But and right now in the markets, you'll see that dual stream is not as good an option as single stream.
Can I ask you a quick question?
Sure.
Before you continue? How much does a new MRF cost?
In the millions, probably $2 to $3 million.
And how old is the one that you have right now?
About 25 years old.
Yeah.
And what's the life expectancy of one of these?
Probably about 25. although a lot of the equipment has been replaced in past years, and some of the equipment is you know, with good maintenance, will last a lot longer than the 25 year life.
I guess where I'm going with that is your numbers all don't reflect anything to that effect of having to. I mean, if you have a life expectancy of 25 years around, and you've been doing the maintenance that you've been doing on it. If you've done good maintenance those 25 years, yeah, it might last longer. But at some point, it sounds to me like you're going to have to get a new MRF, and if it's in the millions.
Yeah, well, that's certainly a good point. It is an aging facility.
Is the world just going to single stream, and are you guys sort of swimming against the current, hoping that the prices are going to go up and the dual stream? You know, I have some bell bottoms and, you know, narrow suits in my closet. And I'm thinking, you know, I'm not going to give those away next year.
You know? That's a good question. And I happen to be a proponent of single stream myself. I should point that out to you. But however, you know, we're willing to work with it. You know, it's a decision that has to be made by the whole board, not just by the chair, unfortunately. The reason I like single stream is because it's a lot easier for the homeowner to be able to recycle. You can recycle more materials with single stream. And I look at it where my concern is keeping stuff out of the landfills. However, the dual stream product is a better product. There are a lot of paper mills out there that won't take single stream paper. They'll only take dual stream paper because there's too much contamination in single stream products. A lot of the stuff that gets sent over to China gets rejected and sent back here. That's why, what's it called?
The green fence.
So there's a plus side to staying dual stream. We can always sell our products, where a lot of single stream products, when the market goes down, they can't sell their products as easily. So there's a value to dual stream, and I recognize that. One of the issues that Jamaica is faced with is we have a very large second home population, and our caretakers who caretake those properties are not going to be required to be licensed haulers, and they're going to have to provide that service to their clients, and it will be a lot easier for them to provide that service with single stream versus dual stream.
And they're in fact probably going to be forced with separating the material because rentals probably aren't going to do it.
Well, right now the law says they only have to provide the service. Yeah. They can't force their customers to do it. But you're right. That's a challenge.
The reality is, right.
Right. The goal, of course, the state is trying to do is to get the commodities out of the landfill, right, and to use them somewhere else. Right. The bottom line, if you look, you can see that if we were to go single stream, that this analysis said we would have had a 6.2% increase in the budget. If we stay dual stream, we might have a 19% increase, but that is totally backward looking. If you look forward, Act 148 is supposed to increase recycling. Well, whenever you increase recycling, the cost to the district of processing single stream will always be a charge. It will never be profitable. I shouldn't say never. Bob cautioned me to use the word never. But in the foreseeable future, given what the commodity prices are, I don't see single stream as ever being profitable, because there will always be a trucking cost to take it from Brattleboro to wherever the facility is. However, with dual stream, if the markets do increase a little bit, we become more profitable, and hopefully the cost will stay down.
We are at dual stream now, and your budget that you're going to vote on tomorrow shows total revenue of 997.
No, this isn't the budget. Oh, you're looking at the budget. Okay, let's look at the budget piece.
And
okay.
Total expenses of $1,515,000. So,
obviously, recycling isn't profitable anyways.
A deficit of $517,000.
Correct.
And so that doesn't sound profitable to me.
No, well, it's never going to be profitable. Okay. As Cheryl just pointed out, recycling is never free.
Okay.
There is a cost to recycling, and the district has recognized that, and there's always been a deficit of somewhere in that range. Last year, the deficit was $490,000. I don't have the previous years, but I think the previous year was $460,000. So there's always been a deficit. You can always expect that there will be a deficit. One of the interesting parts of this budget that we've been discussing at the district, I don't think Cheryl brought it up, is something that we call fee for service, and that's one of the things that Brattleboro and Guilford are pretty concerned about. And what that means is that one of the biggest services that we offer is the coming to your town, picking up those boxes, and bringing it back to the district. Okay, Brattleboro has curbside pickup. What that means is they don't take advantage very much. They have a 24/7 site, I think, at the Fairgrounds Road.
Right.
But a lot of Brattleboro's recycling, they pay the cost of bringing that material to the district. And Brattleboro feels that they're subsidizing some of the outlying towns, especially the towns like Jamaica, which are farther out on Route 30 and have a much smaller population. So therefore, they feel like they're kind of subsidizing those towns with that transportation cost. Guilford's starting to feel that way because Guilford dropped their 24/7 boxes, and now they're not getting any value for that service. We just did a calculation earlier before we came, and Demerston's value there is about $8,000. So about $8,000 of your $26,000 assessment goes towards picking up these boxes in Demerston. What Brattleboro is asking is that we lower the assessment for the transportation costs, and then charge the towns for that service. That's why it's called fee for service. So in essence, our budget for picking up recycling containers is about $185,000. So it's a significant part of that $500,000 deficit. So if we were to reduce the deficit by $185,000, that would reduce your assessment by about, I think we figured
$8,000 or $9,000.
About $9,000. And then if you wanted to have those boxes, then you would pay the $8,000 that it would cost to maintain those boxes. So you would be about net equal if on a fee for service basis. But towns like Jamaica and Windhall would probably pay a little bit more than what they're currently paying for their assessment. And then towns like Brattleboro or Dummer or Guilford that don't use that service would save that money on their assessment.
So
recycling bins are probably the closest ones to the your facility.
Correct.
So your, you know, costs, your transportation costs would, I would think, would be the lowest of any in the district.
Very much so, yes.
Yeah, so, okay.
Right.
Well, also on top of that, Zeke, if you actually look at, I have some numbers here. Dummerston pays $24,407.23 to Wyndham Solid Waste. Out of that, $9,590 is recycling collection. $8,007 is just for the MRF, for the sorting of it, okay? And then you pay $7,000 in for general emission and stuff like that. So that's what one of the things, what we was bringing to the other town's attention, that without these 24/7 boxes, I mean, it's not a big cut in your taxes, but every little bit helps your taxpayers in the towns. But we're feeling it in Guilford. I know you guys are feeling it in Dummerston and stuff like that. With the state making Act 148 come into effect, if your townspeople do not have a private hauler that picks their recycling up, if they take their trash to either Wyndham Solid Waste Management or Triple T or something like that, they have to provide recycling for your taxpayers in the town. That is a state law. And that's one thing what I was arguing with, that what I brought up with this work session what we had in Guilford. Because a lot of towns didn't know it. They didn't know about the whole total of one Act 148. So for them to keep these boxes an extra 6 months out here, I don't understand it.
Well, Vernon also went curbside
recycling. Pay as you throw.
Right. And we as a town wouldn't need the boxes either.
Yeah.
Although Vernon asked specifically to keep those boxes.
Well, because they knew they weren't going to get any money back, so why not?
Right.
Mr. Franklin.
If we've admitted there's a cost to recycling in these boxes, why are we servicing non-member towns? We aren't making anything on it. We're paying to service their stuff.
Non-member towns do get service, but they pay a higher fee. They pay almost a fee for service.
Do they pay any rent or anything on the boxes when they're there?
They have their own boxes, if I recall. Does Weathersfield have their own boxes? I think they do. I think Weathersfield has their own boxes.
Did we just put some in Searsburg, though, when Guilford's came out?
Yes.
Yes, but those are the old boxes. That's correct.
Yep. Oh no, they're the same thing.
We didn't charge Searsburg for those boxes.
I mean, there's a lot of the towns, I tell you, around the old Brookline, their boxes are junk.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're as bad as they get in their member town.
I mean, another point what I want to bring up is the tipping fees in 1990 at the, what we used to call the dump, where you used to drive in down there and just dump your stuff off, all right, was $7 back in 1990, okay? That was to get rid of less than a cubic yard of trash. In 1994, they went up to less than a half a cubic yard, $8 minimum. Spring of 2010, minimum disposal fee of $10 to up to 150 pounds. And then in 2014, they dropped for a 32-gallon bag or smaller, $3 a bag for up to $3 a bag to get rid of trash.
Good point. And the reason for that is because if the purpose of this Act 148 is to reduce the amount of trash that you have.
Mm-hmm.
Now, people like myself, I go to the transfer station probably three times in a month to bring recycling. And only about one of those times do I bring less than a bag. Now, if I was doing that, if I was going to Wyndham Solid Waste as opposed to Jamaica, it would cost me $10 to dispose of that bag, one bag.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that was okay in the old way of doing things, because we were trying not to encourage people to come in with small loads. We would tell people, collect your bags, you know, till you get three or four of them, then bring them in, and they could take those same three or four bags and deposit it for $10. Well, we felt that that was a little bit unfair because people coming in with a single bag shouldn't be charged $10. Would you want to pay $10 for a single bag? So instead, we allow them to bring in three bags for the same $10. It wasn't really a reduction. It was a common sense approach to bringing trash.
But when that's a source of revenue and they're in a hole every year, why would you lower anything and then have to come back to you for more money?
Why would you lower it from, why would you charge somebody $10 for a bag? I guess.
I don't know, but when you guys had the landfill, I'll tell you what, it didn't bother you a bit to torque us every 6 months, raise us.
Well, I can't.
You weren't there then, but I'm telling you, I've dealt with this place for 30 years and I know how it works. Yeah. Well, nobody's responsible for that budget. You guys can just kind of do whatever you want.
Yeah. Okay. Well, anyways, that's the reason why we lowered that fee. It's apparently lower, but it really is.
Okay. Michelle, you're our representative,
yes,
along with Lester Dunkley.
Yes.
What's your take on this?
I had a chance to read the article today that was published in the Reformer and see the quote from John Allen of Brattleboro, who said that there really is no scrutiny of what goes on for the budget. And in fact, in the 7 years that I have been able to represent the town of Dummerston, I have to say that there are 19 towns there who are scrutinizing it. And there are 19 people who sit there who come back and talk to their select boards, just as, you know, we are talking to you tonight, just like Cheryl talks to her select
board,
too.
Not all of the people go back to their select board. That's the problem.
Ah,
there's miscommunication,
yes,
or no communication. And I also came to the meetings where the budget was prepared, and I didn't think there was enough scrutiny. I saw four or five people running the show in the finance committee, and they're just going to make their recommendation to the whole board, and the whole board's going to listen to what they say and just rubber stamp it, unless the town's...
Have you got a copy of the letter from the accountant?
Yeah, this was brought to my attention last night. This is what the CPA writes on his report. It's highlighted in the yellow there.
No, please, go ahead. You like controversy, you take it.
Okay, so I saw this. This is my take on this was, it's just saying how their accounting, his accounting process, and that let me see. How can I say this without getting myself in hotter water? Just the accounting process that he uses is. Let's turn it over to our staff.
Yeah.
I haven't read this yet.
A disclaimer, I guess, is what it is.
Everyone issues those.
Yeah.
For
yeah.
all the years that I stood in as.
I thought it was sort of boilerplate.
It is. I was accounting manager for a number of years for a large distributor. And in fact, my husband is still finance manager for a large manufacturer in Massachusetts. There is a lot of boilerplate that's involved with accounting. And they have to say all those things by law.
Okay.
They have to tell you.
Am I wrong when I say that they brought up that your workman's comp's going to be going up about $7,000 a quarter, but they decided not to show that in the budget because it wouldn't look good?
Workers' compensation gets determined by the state, and it gets reviewed every single year.
Right,
so
but if you're going up and you're not using the new figures of how much you're going up for your new budget, there's something wrong with that budget because you're not using figures that are real.
Well, we usually wait until we get it from the state before we put it on our budget.
Yeah, we actually got these numbers last Thursday, the day we were voting on the budget in the Finance Committee. And
can I see that, Justin?
Sure. And the budget that was passed out to all the members before that meeting did not include it, and the board at that time felt that to start adjusting the budget at the last minute with numbers that just are fresh off the press didn't make sense to them.
at some point, as the select board, you also know when you start working on your budget, I mean, you're probably not going to make every last minute change that could potentially happen in the town budget. Or perhaps you do, right up until the moment it goes to the printer.
Well, up to, what is it, 30 days?
30 before.
Days.
Right. That's what we
anything
do.
Anything that came that changed the
material
would affect the
correct
budget. Yes.
Correct.
Like, wait, we're waiting on our Wyndham Solid Waste
I don't,
District numbers
yes,
to
and
plug
I don't
them
think
in.
We're far enough along in the process yet, other than, as you've heard, you know, the Finance Committee didn't have it last week. I was, available to attend that meeting, and of course, you beat me to it with your invitation because I would have come tonight anyway, since tomorrow night is the last meeting of the year, and asked you if you have an inclination or a preference for which way you would rather see this town represented. I've already told you all of the facts surrounding each of the circumstances of dual stream and single stream. And I, of course, am clearly on the fence. I am representing the town, not my own interests. My own interests lie in doing the best job, which is going to be dual stream. But you've also heard me say repeatedly that I absolutely believe that any change that happens is going to be market-driven. It's going to be driven by what the customers require, and in this case, what the haulers are requiring. So even if we decide, let's ease into something new. Let's ease out of dual stream and perhaps into single stream, but not all at once, because we don't know the true effect of Act 148. And so rather than just, you know, jumping from the pan into the fire, let's at least buy ourselves a slight buffer, a cushion of comfort before we just say, okay, we will cease doing business as a materials recovery facility, continue the rest of the operation for everything else that the district does, and then we could potentially look at using single stream. It's, as has been pointed out, it is not a valuable product. It is not well considered in the market. It's worth very little.
Right. I would like to see your budget be level funded for this coming year while the new act comes into play, and you know, we see how it
part of the reason for the increase then
have that experience to maybe see what direction to go into the following year. That's what personally I would prefer.
And I would agree with you totally on that. In fact, that's the approach we've taken. However, one of the components to Act 148 is an educational component. We have to be out in the schools much more than we are. So what we've done is we've taken a part-time position and made it a full-time position. And that's the reason for, I think it's about a 5% increase in the budget. It's because we must meet that educational component. You'll see the G&A salaries have increased.
Mm-hmm.
And that's because we've added an additional... right now we have for our administrative assistant and a coordinator, we have 7 days for their time. We're upping that to 10 days and making it 2 full-time positions rather than a full-time and a part-time position. So that's the biggest reason why there is a slight increase. But other than that, it is pretty much level funded. I think we also gave a 2% raise to our employees.
5% increase would be nice if we had a 5% increase and were able to call it level funded.
I was going to say, holy crap, we tried for level funded.
You're saying
the general administration deficit is where you're talking?
Specifically, it would be the salaries and component of that particular point. Right, the G&A salaries and wages program coordinator. You see that went up from
salaries and wages through November, though.
Okay.
From 24,000 to 41,000
through the year. That's at 64 cents. And this is this year, not even going
And
forward.
Also the...
And that's for one person to go from part-time to full-time?
Well, actually what it is, it's a person that spends 3 days of her week as recycling coordinator and 2 days a week doing administrative assistant work. She would become 5 days a week recycling coordinator, and we're going to take that person who... her 2 days a week as administrative assistant, plus 2 days a week that we have as a part-time person, we're going to make that one full-time job. So it's kind of reallocating one person to become a full-time recycling coordinator and then having a second permanent person. So that's the salaries and wages and the payroll costs and benefits, which have gone up. That represents pretty much that 5% that 5% increase.
General management
right.
went up another 8,000. General management 30% went up 6,000. That went down. Not stayed the same. You got a few. You want to leave this here for us, and we'll cut it.
You can.
We know how to cut budgets. We'll have this thing cut right down for you.
I'd just like to make one more comment
sure.
about the coming budget and putting the last minute numbers in. The proposed budget going forward for FY 2016 is going to be, like I said, a 5.6% increase, which I didn't agree with all of the numbers they came up with, but it is what it is. But with the workman's comp number that they did get in the day before the meeting, if you throw that number in there, which is a known number, it's going to be a 10.6% increase.
Yeah, and actually, if you want to start adding last minute things, we also have a proposal coming in 1 week, or now 2 weeks, I think it got extended a week, for solar on the landfill. And we don't know what that's going to bring in. That might bring in $50,000, it may bring in $20,000. We're not going to know that for 2 more weeks. But at that point, we're going to be able to take that number and add it to our budget as well, if we want to keep adding things as they come in. So I guess that's part of the reason why they were a little bit hesitant to add this other number in, because we have more numbers that
so
we can add
into. So we're not going to include the workman's comp increase in the assessment that you were going to tell us that we had to pay to you, or?
We were going to just work with that as part of our budget. We're only responsible for the bottom line. We're not responsible for each individual component. And we were going to make sure that we're only held to that bottom line. And we know that our bottom line and the revenue is going to go up because of the lease for the solar on the landfill. We also know we're going to get an additional amount of money for some of the carbon harvest stuff that's coming through. We're going to be leasing in probably another $6,000 in revenue, which wasn't included in this budget as well. So
I just think when you get an actual figure for something, it probably needs to go in. That would be okay. My.
There was.
That's probably true. And however, I will say that we got more actuals coming in as well.
And
they keep
good update them as quickly as you can, but yeah. Certainly when you have a fixed figure like workman's comp, it probably
some
needs
people
to be
wanted that to go in the finance committee, but there were a few that didn't want it to go in because they said if the town see a 10.6% increase, they're going to be jumping up and down. 5%, they'll swallow it.
Mm-hmm. And in the normal course of events, as you know, it's only the board tomorrow night that will look at, you know, the proposed budget by the finance committee and then say yes or no. And then after that, if they say no, obviously even more work gets done. If they say yes, there is still the copy that goes out to 19 select boards, and there's still the public meeting. So there are plenty of other opportunities. We are not closed down, as far as I can tell, to giving a true and accurate assessment of what the budget should be.
But
now, I don't sit on the finance committee, but I try to attend.
The public hearing is on December 30th. How many people are going to be gone between Christmas and New Year's? So
as
how
stated in our charter.
How good of attendance do you think there's going to be on December 30th for a public hearing?
This is a public hearing tonight.
Right.
Yeah,
how's our
attendance? December 30th.
Yeah, although we do... We do get solicitation. We do solicit input from our select board. So our select boards will have the opportunity of giving us their input.
So maybe I'm not understanding it. There's a vote tomorrow on your budget.
On a draft budget.
On a draft budget. Okay.
That's going to show the workman's comp in there, right?
No.
No.
Oh, it's not. It's going to show that just this right here is what it's going to show.
That's what was prepared for the finance committee last time.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. And it is only based on dual stream. You don't have a budget figured for a single stream to give the option.
We asked the board, the full board, about a month ago, to make a decision on whether to go single stream or dual stream, and they voted at that time to stay with dual stream.
What was the vote?
Vote was for our supervisors.
Yeah, 19-0 or?
Oh, what was the vote?
Just off the top of your head.
All 19 towns weren't there. It was probably about 12 or 13 towns were probably there. And it was close to unanimous, I think.
Okay. So this is going to be, the vote is on the draft budget tomorrow. And then on the 30th of December, there'll be a public hearing on the budget. And then after that, when will the budget be a final vote on the budget?
The full board will then vote on it in the January meeting.
January 8th.
One little detail that should be brought up a little bit about single stream versus dual stream. If you go to single stream out of that plant, that was your place from TAN. When if he makes a facility efficient through transfer, it probably will be ruined for dual stream a year and a half from now. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the idea was to run it for, let's see how this thing plays out for 6 months in the next year and then make a decision. More of an accurate decision of what's going to be going on. That's part of the thought process. It was being hashed out in these meetings all the time. Just that, where are you? Where are we going? Well, this Act 148 is put everybody in a uproar. They don't know where we're going. And as you can see, we don't know what we're doing, you know.
The other thing with the MRF, though, that one of the people that TAM that responded to the RFP, he said there would be no reason you would have to shut down the MRF. You could just keep it oiled up. And if you wanted to go back dual stream, it's still there. You don't have to dismantle it and throw it away.
I believe if I read that budget correct too, we're saying that we're going to have to hire another person full time from part time, right?
Right.
And I think if you look at the actual figures, the salaries on there, and what's proposed for down the road, they're proposing less than what they're actually paying now. So if you're going to hire another person full time versus half time, how are you going down?
How are you going down?
Yeah.
In what respect by going down?
What you're proposing in that budget is less than what you're actually paying now.
For salaries? I don't think that's true.
The salary, no, it went up. Well, the administrative expenses went up, and well, salaries went up too.
Well, here's the proposed with the 5.6%. In actual 2013, it was 281,000. In actual 2014, it was 278,000.
For what line item?
The sure. Salaries and wages.
For G&A?
For
no, MRF
processing.
The MRF processing are going down. That's correct. It's the G&A salaries that are going up. That's where the position was added. Part of the reason MRF salaries went down is because we laid off one person last year, and also we had a person pass away with a lot of experience, and we were paying a lot of much more money than the replacement cost.
Sure. So if those are down and we're hiring another part-time person, then wouldn't that be a wash? Wouldn't it be a 5% increase in the budget?
Well, if you look at other items, for example, the recycling collection salaries and wages. I think they went up a little bit. And Yeah, the salaries and wages for recycling collection went up. And again, it's shuffling people around. The total remained about the same. It's just shuffling people. We have people moving from the MRF to transportation. So it's just kind of a shuffling around.
But the problem I have with that is what our CPA prepared from July 1st through November, which I just gave to Zeke.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at, we're at 42% of the year, and if you look at salary and wages in, I can't read upside down, there's the MRF, and there's, this is the convenience center. This one's at 78% of the budget already at 42% of the year. This one is at 46%. This one's at 64%.
0.46%.
Right, but that, yeah, 42% of the year. And they're, what I'm saying is that this year, with 5 months completed, they're more than 5 months into the budget. Mm-hmm. So how do you project that it's going to be less next year? It doesn't seem realistic to me.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, I'm going to shift gears a little bit here and go back to the haulers. How do we anticipate dealing or handling our customer base? Are we going to pick up like recyclables 1 week or 1 day, and then the next day is regular trash? What is there a have the haulers got together and said how are we going?
Everybody will have to do their own thing. It'll be what the customer wants. I mean, if the customer wants to do recycling 1 week, trash next week, that's fine. Some people don't want to do that. They want their trash to go every week, but the recycling will probably be every other week. It'll just get so expensive that, I mean, Josh Kelly from the ANR asked Cheryl on the phone. He says, what do you do with your recycling, and what does it cost? He said, well, we bring it down to Triple T, and he ships it single stream, and we're paying $25 a ton. And he says, well, how can you do that? Because everywhere else in the state's paying $65 a ton. And the difference is private sector or through the districts. You're just putting another hand in the pie.
We, for example, like out at the school, Tim and Cheryl Franklin Rubbish picks up that out at the Yoper School. Mm-hmm. I'm the head of maintenance out there.
Mm-hmm.
When this all started, I went from a 6-yard dumpster down to a 4-yard dumpster at the school. They picked my trash, my dumpster up once a week, which is on Tuesdays, and they picked my recycling up on Mondays. We went out and we had some, like the big Rubbermaid totes, bins, mm-hmm. ones on wheels and stuff mm-hmm. like that. We have a recycling program out there at the school. We do paper, plastic bottles, so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. We haven't got into the composting and stuff like that yet, but we're starting that within the next year or two to get ready for 2020 for when that comes along. But we went down to that, and Tim's son, Nick, that drives one of the trucks, he comes every Monday, goes out to the bins. I have the kids help me because it's part of their curriculum.
Mm-hmm.
They help me put it in bags. I go out there, Nick unties them, dumps them in his thing, and it's all mixed, crushes it, drives out the gate. See you later. It's working great. Before, I had to take and separate everything and drive it down to the Guilford store in the back of my pickup truck.
Mm-hmm, right, yeah.
Which was, okay, like a day today, I'd be drenched by the time I got rid of 9 or 10 bags.
So is there a cost savings to you? I mean, because you've got a smaller dumpster.
I believe the dumpster, when I went to a smaller dumpster, the price went down on the dumpster.
But then you add the extra stock for the recycles.
I have not seen the bill. That goes to central office with that right there.
But the cost of that doesn't equal
the savings on the
dumpster. Because to get rid of trash, it costs $100.
Right, yeah.
A ton versus 25.
Yeah. Okay.
So as long as you can keep those trips picking up the recycling to a minimum,
mm-hmm.
you can save people money
mm-hmm.
on what they put into the recycling side.
Thank you.
If I can just get back to the workers' comp, do I understand the budget tomorrow is not going to include workers' compensation?
The Finance Committee voted on a budget last Thursday to propose to the to the full board, which is tomorrow night.
Yes or no?
At that time, there was no knowledge of that particular at that particular figure. So therefore, they chose not to include it because otherwise it would mean going back and reevaluating the budget. However, they also chose not to include, as I said, other things that we expect to come in on the revenue side.
Okay.
So we're expecting
it doesn't include the workman's comp.
That's correct.
Okay. So.
But it does. There is a line item in here for workers' comp under the MRF.
Not the additional amount, is what
right. Okay.
We're
lacking.
But it wouldn't have been very hard to put the number in there.
Okay. So, gentlemen, what do you want to do here? Got any more questions?
I think it's great to have this input. This was a great
mm-hmm.
dialogue, and I appreciate everybody coming.
Yes, mm-hmm. and that we have
whether
had,
we agree or disagree.
My talk is trash.
Yeah.
It's certainly been a good dialogue.
Yes.
It opened my mind to some things
well,
that I guess I hadn't thought about yet.
Is that we need to have more people aware of what's going on
exactly,
and give people the choice to do what they want going forward with Act 148.
Right. We have had no.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, myself, I'm not saying that they're doing a bad job up there. My brother-in-law started this recycling program with the igloos 25-something years
ago. Oh, really?
Okay, so, you know, when he worked there. So, I mean, I think it's a great program. And, I mean, I've even cut back on my trash at my house. So, you know, it's great. So,
mm-hmm.
but I think it needs to be tightened up to help the towns in the surrounding areas. And I think they really can do it.
I'd be interested in knowing what you feel about the two primary issues, one regarding single stream and the other, the fee-for-service. I'd be interested in whether you think that the fee-for-service, for example, is a good idea, or whether you like the idea of all the groups just combining their resources and then just paying for that service as a group. And also, what you think about single stream versus dual stream. Maybe you haven't gotten a chance to have digested that enough. But.
Well, we're so close that I like the user fee. I mean, we're pretty close.
Yeah.
So for us, that's
sure.
Right.
You know, that's
right.
Pretty easy decision. But
the same as Reedsboro,
right.
To haul these bins.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's nice if you know. It's all for one for all, but actually when we have to do our budget, it'd be nice if we were actually paying the actual cost of doing that.
Mm-hmm. And I think personally, when you look at the rural setting that we're dealing in, other than the Bradboro itself, I think you're probably looking at single stream being the only efficient way to do things, but I could be wrong. It's
just
there's a difference when you're talking about Essex or Burlington or maybe Bradboro than you are Dummerston and Windhall and Marlboro or whatever.
Yeah.
It's just a financial reality that
mm-hmm.
single stream might be the only way we could effectively do it. I don't know.
It will be market driven, and it may be that dual stream simply fades away because
which is sad, but
it's the way that people want convenience. So you know, we can't ignore it, and. As you recall me back in August saying the few surveys I took when I was up at the bins up here, those folks did not use haulers. They all took their own trash to the district on their own schedule, which was infrequent, and they were very, very vehement about wanting to continue to use the recycle bins. And of course, I knew that the flip side of that coin is that that's a great cost in the district and as part of all our line items in every town's budget. I think I would just say, what is your pleasure, gentlemen?
I guess to back up to that, I would say, what's more efficient, a one truck going to 100 residences or 100 residences driving to a central point? I mean,
mm-hmm.
when you start talking about energy conservation, it might be much more effective to have one vehicle going to all the places.
Right.
This is why I was getting to, I wish we could somehow, we certainly wouldn't want to contract with one hauler because competition is good, but it does bother me to see three trucks on our road. When,
well, you see the same thing with your oil truck.
Oh yeah, I know. Yeah. Yeah, school buses are worse to me than the transit.
Yeah, and even excavating, I mean, so this guy can only...
Oh sure, go to excavating.
You're saying it's the same thing though.
Well, I brought it up, didn't
I?
Oh, God.
We started single stream recycling back in July when Guilford got rid of their boxes, I believe it was. And we've had
great reception to it, to the people that are doing it. They love it. They just keep praising. They say, oh, you made my day, you made my year. I love you, I love you. That's what they tell me on the phone, you know. It's like, they love
it. So the option be, if we went, I'm sorry.
Don't, go ahead. Go ahead.
There'd still be boxes
at the
district mm-hmm. that people could still go to if they didn't go to the ones here at Dummerston, for instance.
Correct.
Yeah, and even so if far. People bring their own into, like, Bramble Salvage, they have to provide the recycling.
Right, yeah.
So when you take the trash back, you take the recycling back. It's not saying that because you don't have a hauler, you can't recycle. Nothing changes. I mean, you just do your own.
Yeah.
So is the if you take your recycling there, is it free or is there a fee?
If you take it to the district?
No, if you take it to, like, Brattleboro Salvage.
I'm not, I know I have to pay because I'm commercial.
Yeah, I would think there'd be a fee if you went there. Yeah, the district.
I'm not sure of that.
That's a good question.
Yeah.
I think about that too. But from the district's perspective, it's free to take it to the district.
Right.
And what Michelle was just saying is that most of your people already go to the district with their trash. So, but however, they probably go less frequent with their trash than they go with their recycling. And that, in fact, that's what we're hoping is the case. So the question then becomes, is it just a convenience we're providing by having your box here in Dummerston, because they could still take it, and go down. Most people go to Brattleboro probably weekly, and they could still take it to the district, but they just wouldn't be bringing trash that particular day.
Michelle, how many people did you talk to up there?
Very few. I only just started on the survey. They were not popular.
There was only
was very time consumptive.
Three or four people?
Yeah.
Didn't you say mostly
there
were
up to five?
Oh, was it five people?
But
were most of them, if I remember correctly, second homeowners?
Only one.
Only one of them. Okay.
Yeah, only one.
But I mean, at the cost of $200,000 plus per year, just for a little bit of convenience.
Yeah,
that's what people do.
And
now.
I kind of agree with you.
So there's going to be a bunch of vote
yes.
tomorrow. If our representative wanted some advice from the legislative body here, what advice would you give her?
I'd tell her to tell them I want to see a budget with a single stream too, not just dual stream. I would want to see the choices I have, and I'd want to see all the numbers. I'd want to see that 10%. I'd want to see the numbers that you actually had.
It would be actually pretty similar to this particular.
Yeah, I've got that right here.
Right, it would be very similar to the. One of the we haven't discussed yet whether we like the triple T option or the TAM option. The TAM option is cheaper. The triple T option gives us the value, the benefit of using that building for something else.
Mm-hmm.
So there's what's the value of that? We haven't really.
Yeah. And I'd also tell her that I tell the finance thing that I'm very disappointed in them with not having the workman's comp.
Mm-hmm.
The numbers that you have are the numbers that you should be working with.
Workman's
if you don't,
yeah.
if you don't, well, whatever numbers that you actually have, I don't care if you got them the day before, you put it in there and you show the numbers that you actually have. You don't not show a number just because either it's going to inflate it or it's going to decrease it. But I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, I know a lot of people, but if it was going to decrease that number, it might have been in there. But it's going to increase it, and it's not going to look good for the towns. I think it should be there. Any number that you have, whether it's going to decrease it or increase it, you should have it in there. If it's a number that you just don't know, you can't do it, but you've got the number. Put it in there.
Understood.
Would you like me to include like some revenue from the solar on the landfill?
Do you have those numbers?
We have to guess at that number.
I don't want guesses.
I mean, unless you had an actual contract that reflected an actual number. I mean, this is how we deal. We have to deal with actual.
Yeah, what you've
numbers.
Got an actual.
It's
right.
great that potential's
a,
there.
You've
we
got
don't have
potential
actual
for something.
For single stream.
Right.
Yeah.
So again,
you got proposals
though.
You got the proposal. That's what
yes,
you. That's what you'd work on. I mean, because
right.
you don't have it because you haven't taken it and put it into a budget, because it's a proposal. I mean, you've got the proposal, so it could be a budget.
Have any sage advice for them?
No, I really appreciate
okay.
these folks coming and taking the time to talk to us. Whether we've been, agreeing with them or disagreeing. Yeah. It was very nice of them to take the time tonight to come, all of you.
Yeah, I'll echo that sentiment in that it's very good to have a lively debate.
Yeah.
It's great to hear different voices.
I don't know how much of a debate it really is, because it really sounds like you guys sort of agree that a single stream is a way to go. I mean, you said you...
I prefer it myself.
Right. I mean, so it's not...
Except I'm only one of 19, so...
Yeah.
Right. Each town, with the exception of Brattleboro, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, Brattleboro has 5 votes, right?
Yes. Westminster has 2.
Yes.
Three. Everyone else has
2. 2 or 3?
Two.
Three.
Two.
Oh, it
was 2. It was 2, I'm sorry.
So
majority actually is, they can go there and be outvoted. But, I mean, it's up to the boards to tell their reps
the boards to
what they want
done. Do you have
done.
Any sage advice for
them? You know, it sounds like a single stream is just a matter of when. And I agree with Lewis that, I mean, you should have something in there for workers' comp. I mean, I can't imagine it changes that much, isn't it? Just it's a percent of payroll.
What's happened is, is we've had some accidents at our facility in the last 3 years that have, number one, we lost the benefit of having an accident-free shop, so that brought our number up, and then also paying for these accidents, we have to pay for them for the next 2 or 3 years.
They were saying it went from this 5.6 to 10 or more than 10.
Just shy of 11.
Increase,
I mean, that's a definite deficit. It's not a revenue.
Yep.
You know, you have to pay that out. So that should definitely be in your budget versus a revenue where you may get $20,000 back for the solar or whatever, you know.
Yeah, and I do like using Triple T if that's how it works, because you can keep your facility there if in the future we find that dual stream is something we can utilize. Like, you know, it's always hard.
They,
and
they
need to keep your options.
Triple T now, don't you, Lou?
Pardon me?
Don't you guys use Triple T now to take your number 3 through number 7 recyclables down
there? No, we actually bail them at the moment.
Oh, you haven't bailing them?
There was a while that we didn't bail them.
Because I know that they was, he wasn't getting nothing for them, just your number 1s and number 2s.
Right, there was a while we didn't because there was no market for them. But we've now found a market again.
$0.03 a pound.
Yeah, but
the other thing that occurs to me, I mean, you got a lot of volume you're dealing with, and to be thinking about putting all that on trucks and taking it all the way up Route 9 through Wilmington, you know, down Bennington way, I mean, that's a pretty scary drive.
Well, and there's every good chance that it could go up. Remember, if people don't want to pay, you know, to throw away that much trash, they might actually start recycling. Even if, you know, a couple of towns decide, well, I'd rather go single stream and we're not going to deal with the district, those who remain will almost certainly see an increase. I mean, it might be slow to start, but my guess is that it's going to happen.
So I would like to see this budget voted down. I think a 10% increase with the workers' comp figured in, or 11% increase, is too high. I thought 5.6 was too high. I would have liked to have seen it lower than that. I understand you're going to give employees a 2% wage increase, and I'm okay with that. But I would vote against this budget and send it back to be worked on more and winnowed down, have the figures for workers' comp added into it, and just work through it. And just like we would do with our road foreman, we find places where we can cut and see how the new law changes things and evaluate the single stream, double stream next year.
And the other thing too is if it gets voted down, which I would recommend too, you may also, in that time, while they're working on that, actually get real numbers for the solar. So you could put those numbers in there. You know what I'm saying? The real numbers are what we work with. And so if those numbers come in, you get somewhere where it says that you're going to get this, by all means, I'd have that in my budget. But, right?
See, your words are representing the entire board, correct?
No, I'm speaking for myself. We haven't.
And I just spoke for myself that I would vote it down.
So we've got 2.
I concur.
Yeah, I would concur. I think the workers' comp issue is a big issue. I just think your actual figures need to be in there.
And that's not a bad idea necessarily, because hopefully by the 30th we will have those numbers for the solar and we'll be able to incorporate
it. It'll look great. We'll come back down and carry you around on our shoulder. Duodara, what's your...
I don't want to render an opinion at this juncture.
Okay. So we have four members...
with a clear direction.
Yeah, and one abstaining.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And I also think I heard you say that if you had a choice between fee-for-service and not, you'd prefer fee-for-service. Did I hear that correctly?
So well, it makes sense, being the closest.
Yeah, yeah. My understanding is we come out better that way.
Yeah.
That's without looking at the figures, it seems like that would be better for Dummerston.
And the reality is we might end up getting rid of the containers anyway. I mean,
yeah, and we're going to, the reason we gave it 6 months to evaluate is because just as coincidentally, that's going to take us right through our budget process of next year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So during that 6 months, we'll know by next year's budget whether those are legitimate or not.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to thank you all for coming. And I'd like to thank... Michelle and Lester for representing the town at these meetings. And I thank you all for coming and behaving civilly. We weren't sure how things were going to go, but it was a good discussion.
Very good discussion.
Yeah. Thank you very much for coming.
Good night.
Thanks for
having us. Yeah.
See you tomorrow,
see
Cheryl.
Must be the rest of our meeting isn't very interesting.
I just brought along, if anyone wants to read, the summary of the new requirements for the education outreach.
Oh, yeah.
Which is the background for the increased time for the position.
Yep.
You want those?
Yes.
Okay, it's right out of the act. And then I put in there what it costs to do the household hazardous waste.
Okay.
Collections, which is something we did. So thank you.
Very good. Thank you for coming.
Yeah.
Keep in mind also in the future that not tomorrow or next week or next year there will be the entire issue of collecting compostable possible waste.
Why, that'll be
very interesting.
Yeah.
Very interesting. But the district already does compost.
Yeah.
The law states
that
if you're going down 142 through Vernon, we've had a compost drop-off bin for 5 years now. And once we started paying to throw, and I live in Vernon, we doubled the amount of people using that because instead of paying $3 a bag, you know, they're...
Yeah.
And also, it's a lot of weight, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And the other thing is that the bins in Vernon, the Vernon Select Board said, let's leave the bins, even though we have curbside every week recycling. We've increased the tonnage in those. Because some people continue to recycle, they like to go there.
Yeah.
The compost is there, the clothing recycling.
Mm-hmm.
So there's some options to put food waste recycling at your dumpsters, at your 24/7 boxes, if you needed that in the future.
Mm-hmm. Are they bear safe? I've never seen the compost dumpsters. So.
Not really.
Okay.
They do make them. Dover's got one now.
Okay.
Has there been a problem with bear in Vernon?
No.
Vernon's not quite as rural
as... If I don't see you before the end of the year...
Yeah, thanks for your efforts.
Yeah, sure. Thank you very much for the work.
From my perspective, Michelle's been a very valuable addition.
We have heard nothing but great reports.
And even though Lester doesn't vote when Michelle's there, Lester adds a lot because of his experience.
We're lucky to have them.
I think you really are.
Yep.
Easy news.
Yep.
Very good.
Thanks. Yep. Good night.
Thanks for coming.
You're welcome.
No,
We need the minutes and the warrants to sign.
Who's responsible for bringing that folder?
Z. The last one to...
Here, pass those five...
education.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
I need more papers.
You're done?
Desserts.
Where can I have time to go? Okay.
Gonna have to have Lewis chair a few of these meetings so we can move them along. Okay. That was a good discussion.
I think you did. Good discussion.
That was a very good discussion.
Yep. Okay. Yeah. Here's our portion of the program, recognition of visitors and public comments. Anyone? No, I guess we'll just go ahead. Let's see. The highway report. Okay, we have a request from Sandra Campbell. I guess when they were using the grader to take down some snowbanks, her stone wall was hit, and the road crew came out and tried to repair it. Sandra Campbell thought it still needed some work. She hired a stone wall person, and she is wondering if the town will cover the cost of $220.
I just will disclose that Sandy's a customer of mine, but being in the town right away, which I believe Lee looked into that, Lori, and it is in the town right away, and as badly as I feel about it, I know of other instances in other towns where this same thing has happened, and the town has not contributed to the repair at all. I'm thinking particular one in Williamsville, and I just think it's an unfortunate thing that happened because of the deep snow, and I'm not sure we have liability for that.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing, and I know there's some fences that are in the right of way, and every year they seem to get kicked out, and what we'd end up having is we'd have people coming up and asking for those fences to be repaired. It's
right. I'd have my wife wanting to get paid for chickens. We're gonna need. That was my next thought. Yeah.
Well, does Lee have an opinion whether that horizontal jutting rock face is a problem for the plows this winter? I mean, what is his take on
it? It's fixed now.
She has stone that was sticking out. And so
was that was her choice. So, of course, the still question is whether or not Lee evaluated the situation and said, well, that's, in fact, a hazard. If you don't deal with it, you'll have to.
I think it's the way Lee left it, is what her problem is. See, because Lee, somebody hit it with the grader, and they realized they hit it with the grader. They went out and did the best they could to repair the stone wall. So I would assume that Lee was thinking that it was okay for the next time he went by with the grader.
I see.
If he, I'm assuming.
Okay.
You know, because he left it that way. And it was in the town right of way, which.
Mm-hmm. Right, okay, thank you.
Yeah, she contacted Lee. Lee came out during the summer, some of the crew, and they tried to repair the wall to the best of their ability.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel badly, but I'm going to move to not pay any funds for the repair of that, being it's in the right of way.
That's a motion?
Yes, that's a motion.
Second.
Okay. Any more discussion? Yes, I think I know of other fences that have been in the right of way and been hit by the snow plow or something, and they're just in the right of way.
It's not something they try to do?
No, no. And Lee did assure me they know where the stone wall is and they'll be very careful. So we have a motion, it's been seconded, to not reimburse this. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Yeah. So, well, would you like me to contact Sandra Campbell?
Sure.
Okay.
That would be great.
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah, I will give her a call. Now, correspondence for information. Let's see. Anything there you want to go over? Okay.
Okay, if not, correspondence for discussion and or action. I don't think there's anything in the folder.
No, there's not.
Oh, okay. Not that I'd be able to find it anyway, but unfinished business. We could continue to work on the budget, or if you want, we could just skip over that and take care of the new business.
I would recommend that we review Lori's figures that she's given us for our next budget session meeting, and because it's been a long, drawn-out meeting, we just move on to new business.
I would concur.
Okay. And?
That's me.
Lewis?
I was looking forward to going over the budget, but I see three people already said no, so... Yes.
Do you guys want to go have a
Lewis
have a
could stay here
something
later.
And
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Talk it over. Let's just a. I'll keep it brief. But anything in particular that you wanted to?
No, I was just thinking.
Yeah, I was thinking we. I was thinking we'd hopefully get it. Fill in the holes that we have at our next meeting, so we could. See, you know, get some grand totals and then see, like we're suggesting the Wyndham Solid Waste Management District do.
I was thinking we could just plug the numbers we wanted now.
Okay. What ones do you...
Well, let's do the Wyndham Solid Waste Management Assessment.
Well, one thing I believe that you also need to discuss is the health insurance.
Okay. Let's do that. Wyndham Solid Waste, do you think they're going to level fund it, or...
No, I don't. I wish I could say they were going to, but...
Let's see what they do at their meeting tomorrow.
Right.
The health insurance... where are we?
And the professional services, that's Fisher & Fisher, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And we did get a bill from Fisher & Fisher to give us...
And that's reflected in
the... Right.
Right. So we had penciled in $5,000. In there.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, at the meeting that you weren't at.
Okay.
Right. And?
I feel comfortable. We leave it right
at five?
At five.
Yeah. And above that, meetings and trainings, we had penciled in. This was, again, when Lori wasn't there. We raised that 200 to 300.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
And then... Under select board expenses, above that, we'd the 400 we'd reduce to 200.
What about legal notices?
Excuse me. Legal notices, 400.
We're at 57 this year. We're 2014. We were only at 293. I think we could come down to 300 with that.
Any thoughts on that?
And their rates keep going up.
Yeah, their rates.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering if we can switch over to the commons.
Right. We could, can't we?
I believe we can, because at the organizational meeting, after town meeting, the board is supposed to designate a newspaper of record. So I think you could... But I told Zeke that I will check with the LCT to find out if it has to be a daily newspaper or if it can be a weekly newspaper. Mm. But their rates are considerably...
Can you check? We have that before next meeting.
Sure.
Yep. So
yep.
Leave it at four now. Just put an asterisk next to it or something so we know we can...
Sure. Yeah. I'll must be okay putting 300. But
all right. I like that.
Put 300 in.
300, yeah. And
okay. Health insurance. Do you want to discuss the health insurance now?
I think Lori said she'd like to discuss that now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's time. Is of the essence in that decision.
Okay. We had discussed... we're going to have more people, but that health reimbursement account of $11,250 that's going to go back into the general fund. So that's essentially...
It's not, it won't go back into the general fund. It's going to be held in reserve, like an escrow account.
Okay. And we can do that. Is that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the amount of money to cover another employee to have the same policy or... let's see, we can't choose for the employees.
You can't
choose,
you have to do a dollar amount.
The dollar amount that would cover the same policy that we have now.
Right.
With the same amount put into that HRA.
Mm-hmm.
And then increasing the amount of the HSA, the health savings account, by, is it $50?
$50, yes.
Yeah. We would be coming up, the number that we would plug in to here would be $32,687.60.
Is that right?
I'm looking for, oh, there, I've been looking for that. Thank you, Warren.
The cost would be $32,687.60.
Okay. I had debated, you know, in my mind, you know, should we ask the employees to, you know, split that $50, you know, but I thought, well, they're good employees.
And their out-of-pocket for prescriptions is increasing by $50 as well, and they had...
Okay.
Put in for the employee to absorb that.
Okay.
Increase.
Okay, so
right.
I'm okay saying we will, in the budget that we present at town meeting, we will cover that extra $50.
In the deductible?
Yeah.
Okay.
Or the contribution to the, will increase our health savings contribution
by
$50.
Okay.
Yeah.
Over last year.
All right.
Sounds good. What's the number that you want to put in on the budget now?
If I'm correct,
yeah,
it would be the $32,687.60.
Right. And that covers everything. That covers the HSA, the HRA, and the premium.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
For four people.
Right.
So that's a $2,050 increase over last year.
I have it being, let's see.
Well, that's because this includes the payment in lieu.
Okay, this figure?
$32,000, yeah.
Right.
That includes the $2,000 payment in lieu of health insurance.
Okay.
Because there's only one employee who will be taking that this year.
Oh, okay.
Instead of two.
And so the actual cost last year was $34,632.
Hmm.
Right.
Oh, right, because we're taking that 2,000. Okay, yep, so it's...
Okay.
And in actuality, this number will be less because I won't be going on the insurance until March 1st.
Right.
So there's 2 months of one premium that...
Of course, this budget doesn't, you know, even begin to take place until June, end of June, so...
That's true. So
this is where I need the duct tape around my head to keep it from...
And this actually, this figure reflects what's being carried forward from the
HRA.
Yeah. Otherwise, this would be significantly more. Yeah.
Well, that's my question. What's going to happen next year? Are we going to be going up 11,250?
No.
Is this a...
Wait.
Is this a one-time...
Single stream or double?
No, this is not a one-time thing, providing that no employee has to use what's in the HRA.
Okay. Yeah, and they, you know, one employee, they can't draw off the 11,000.
Right.
Each employee has a certain amount that they can use.
Okay.
And then what's not used at the end of the calendar year goes back to the town.
So theoretically, there could be more money in this next year if it's not used this year.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
or less.
Or less,
yeah.
A little bit, yeah.
Let's hope everyone has a safe and healthy year.
Yes, including us.
Yeah. Want to do anything about select board salaries?
So can you, I'm sorry, but can you approve this? So that Pam can go ahead and enroll?
I'll make a motion that we do the 32,687.67 for the health insurance.
60 cents.
I'd second
which
that.
Which is a monthly premium of $436.20.
Yeah, that's what I said. That was
my
motion.
Oh, I'm
there.
Sorry.
Yeah, you didn't hear that?
No.
Yeah.
I think I was interrupting him. I didn't see him saying it. So you got a motion and a second?
Did you second
that? I did second.
Oh, okay. Any further discussion? All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Passes unanimously. See, you didn't want to talk about the budget, you know?
Yeah, well, we haven't got to the sheriffs and the state police yet.
Sorry to have fun. Whoa, that's when we're going to really have fun. Okay. Well, select board salaries? Good.
Yeah, I thought we were going to discuss that.
It's hard to spend all that money, so
yeah,
probably ought to leave it alone.
Oh, I'm happy with making it a volunteer position. Out of civic duty.
I'm not that happy myself, but I was thinking, you know, I could go a little less, but
I think you leave it alone personally. We have a significant amount of out-of-pocket expenses.
Okay.
I would agree with Steve.
Okay. All right. I will move on. But that fills in, other than our Wyndham Solid Waste Management District, that fills in that category. Wages, town report, typist. That's what I... Well, anything else? Going down to administration, anything else there? Did we go over that? I think we did.
On the town report typist,
yes.
The auditors haven't given us a budget yet, so I just put in what had been there years past. But the typist who has been me for the past 5 or 6 years,
yes.
I'm proposing to not get paid extra for typing the town report, because I sometimes have time to work on it during the day, so that's why it was only $300 last year, and that went to Whitney. I just did it out of my salary, so I'm proposing that be zero instead of $800.
All right. Do you want to be want us to carry you around
now? No, thank you very much.
Okay.
I'll pass.
All right, we'll save it up for you. Okay.
Well, if I know it was you, it would have been zero anyway.
Okay, town report.
There's some money towards the state police.
Okay. Okay. The next page, you know, we will have to decide, you know, what percent wage increase we want. But going down, what do you want to do about the request for clerical help for the planning commission? Do you need to recuse yourself just to preserve domestic harmony?
I'll just state my position is that they're pretty well done with the zoning, and I would think that would have been where it would have been the most helpful. I think
I'll have to agree with Steve. They don't need it. That's what Steve Blayback said.
It's right on TV.
Yeah, it's right on TV. So,
I don't know. It seems like somewhere where we wouldn't need to spend the money, but
right.
I think they passed the zoning. My understanding is they passed the zoning. Rewrites the other night, and they're scheduled to
meeting in April or something like that.
I want to do so.
So when this budget takes place on July 1st, it will have been too little too late as far as the bylaws go.
Let's hope so.
Yeah. So yeah. Let's maybe
think on that one.
Yeah. Hold it off until the next town plan.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense to me.
So I think we ought to zero that out.
Okay. All right.
Don't say it, Steve. More money for the state police.
Okay. Now let's see. Municipal building. Okay. Building maintenance.
We put in $600.
Yep.
Today, and that was the only things we included in that were to have these floors stripped and waxed again, which we had done about 7 years ago,
mm-hmm.
and the windows washed, I think it was $75. So.
Okay.
Lori, when you're here during the day,
uh-huh.
you know, and you have you're not typing the town report, if I get you some Windex.
Yeah, no problem.
Okay, the 12 lawn care, does that reflects the casting?
Yes.
New figure?
Yeah.
Okay. And the copier expense, that's the newest figure that Pam got?
That is the newest figure from today.
Okay.
Considered the US.
Great. Computer expense, okay.
I had to check with her, though, because I'm not sure she included paper in with that. So I'll check with her tomorrow.
All right. Okay. Okay. Do you want to talk about the public safety?
I just had a thought, and we don't need to put a figure in here, but here's what I would like to have us consider before the next meeting. If we were to leave the sheriff's department where it was at the 9,600, but schedule the sheriff's department 5 hours a month for 11 months, and added $3,600 in there for the state police. You know, we are getting more break-ins. I think visibility for the sheriff's department and the state police is a public safety benefit to everybody in town, and I'd just like us to consider that. It would be basically at $3,600 we can only have them 11 months out of the year, so we'd have to pick a month basically where we didn't use them at all. And one other month, instead of 5 hours, it would have to be 4 hours to get it come to 3,600. But
okay.
I enjoyed the other day. They were sitting out on Route 5, and traffic slowed right down. I've seen them up here recently. It's just nice to have another, and I'd like us to consider it. It doesn't have to go in there tonight, obviously, but
okay.
I'd like us to think about it.
I have a sheet that I had written down all these great. No, here it is. Wow.
Steve, right. Do you have any data in terms of the rise in number of break-ins in town that you're referring to?
No, I probably could get that though.
I mean, that would influence me if I saw the crime rate going up.
I mean, we just had another break-in on Kipling Road
mm-hmm.
last week. Let me see if I can try to.
Okay, so I've been thinking about this too. Let me run this past you. Let's see. In October, the sheriff's, we pay $800, which is at $43.25, supposed to get us, you know, there in the contract, 18.5 hours a week. October, they were at 13 hours. You know, so that brings our cost to $61.54. September, they were 11 hours, which brings it up to 72.73 cents, which is the state police cost. August, they were at 15 hours. July, they were at 15 hours. And June, they were at 18.25. So that these are the figures for this fiscal year so far. So I was thinking, and this is just running it up the flagpole, as we say, we could say we just budget 14 hours for the sheriff's department. That would give us a $2,334 savings out of the $9,600. We apply that to the state police, and we could do, you know, 4 hours a month would be $288 a month. So if we went to 5 hours a month, it'd be 360. Or 6 hours a month, it'd be 432. With that $2,334 in savings from the sheriff, you know, rolled into the state police, for the 4 hours, we'd need an additional $1,122 a year. For the 5 hours, we'd need an additional $1,986. And if we went for the 6 hours, we'd need an additional $2,850. So.
What is the $72 per hour for state police?
Isn't that what the state police?
I had $66.25.
Wow, okay.
Wow, you can get more hours.
Okay,
then.
No, I had read it at some place.
$63 plus $13.25.
Oh, whoa. Back to my...
Unless that was the original email estimated it?
Yeah, I think it was the original...
Yeah, okay, where he was estimating the
email. So that's the actual figure he came in at? 66?
Yeah, this was the proposal that we...
Okay.
That we got in writing, anyway.
So, well, buy us a little bit.
A little bit. Either more time or...
Yeah. So that's what I was thinking.
Doesn't, and I guess I'd have to check, but doesn't the Sheriff's Department try to balance their hours out? In other words, won't there be months where we get more than the hours? Don't they make
these up? That's what it's supposed to be, but he went back the last 6 months, and the only month that they were at 18 was a month was actually last budget.
At the end of the fiscal year.
Right.
So this whole fiscal year, the most he's done is 15 hours, right? Mm-hmm. And that was my, that's what was my issue with the whole thing is, so next June, we're going to get 44 hours of service next June, which he could do. I'm not saying that's how he's going to do it, but that's what could happen, is we could get 44 hours from him. That's why it should be a month-to-month rate, so we get the 18 hours. And I guess like Zeke's proposal, I sort of like it, is if he took out the average of how many hours he was working the last 6 months, said let's go to that, pay him that, and take those dollars and put it over to the state police.
So we have them working essentially what they're averaging now, and we get the state police in here for more.
But we don't get more hours of coverage, which is what I'll look into how many break-ins and what, but I would like to see us get more hours to coverage. I mean, that's what the fire department and the police department and the sheriff's department is something that benefits every single residence in town, where some of these other things might only benefit certain people. And I think as crime increases...
Yeah, that the sheriff's going to be looking more for speeding. And,
yeah.
You know,
but just to have a vehicle
nice
in town,
where
I think, helps.
Where I'm hoping the state police will be more, you know, cruising through, going around. That's what I would think. We'd want less traffic control, more presence in town.
I would encourage the people in town to let us know what their thoughts are, either by calling board members or whatever, and see what people in town would like to do. I personally would like to see more. I think when you look at the cost of a cruiser, the cost of training the officer, the overhead, you know, $9,600 doesn't buy a lot.
Especially when they don't.
Yeah.
Since June, they're supposed to do 18.5, so they haven't reached their contract.
And that's an issue that we should be discussing with them.
We discussed it with them last year.
Yeah, that's true.
And it can't keep being thrown back to the last administrative.
No, that was only one issue went back there. The other issue that they've had was they had the
mental health.
Mental health. Yeah. Now they got Vernon.
Yeah.
It's always something.
Yeah.
I mean, the reality is we're paying for services we're not getting.
Right.
We can't say that, really, because the contract we signed that he had to sign was that he is going to make up X amount of hours.
Right. We'll get paid those amount of hours. Lewis's concern is, and well-founded, that we would get all the hours in 1 month.
I understand.
Rather than staying at 20 or...
And if you want, a cruiser going around town, you'd get more of it if they were doing the 18.5 hours,
right,
rather than the 13 hours and the 15 hours.
I don't disagree with you. I want more police coverage, so I'm not happy that they're not meeting their hour requirements at all.
I guess what I tried to say is that for the last 6 months, we've not been getting, you know, what we've been paying for. I mean, yeah, you can look at the whole year, but...
Well, that's what our contract is.
By the, you know, taking the $800 a month, you know, it averages out to, you know, close, either above or close to the state police figure. So let's use that money and have the state police and have both agencies in
I think
town.
The state police are more of a presence too.
More of a deterrent.
Right.
I personally would like to see us get more coverage, but that's my personal opinion. So I don't care if it's with the state police or the sheriff's, but I would like more than 18 hours a month.
Sure. I'd like to get 18 hours a month for starters.
Do you want me to follow up with him again and find out why we're not doing that, or don't bother?
I mean, like I said, all he has to say is the contract says you'll get your hours.
Right, yeah.
You know, we're busy right now, and that's what he told us. Is he's going to have his busy time, and then he'll find time to get us, make up our hours. My concern was just this when I told him that I don't like it because you're going to make it up in June.
Okay.
I don't know if there's any use talking to him about it.
Okay.
So I'm up for increasing the amount of money that we spend on this. I'm just, I'd like to change the allocation.
Hope we can get more hours.
The state
that would
police.
Be the 18 hours a month isn't a lot of hours for...
I think he has to change his numbers. When he changes his numbers down, when he changes his numbers down, that's going to increase the hours, first thing.
Well, we'll have the accurate number.
Right.
Then we can choose, well, do we want 4 hours, 5 hours, 6 hours?
I see, okay.
So
I think that's the next meeting.
I'll sharpen my pencil.
Right.
Do those numbers, and it's 6.
I thought I forwarded you this, Zeke. I will forward you.
Okay.
I thought I did with that email, but...
Okay. You know, maybe there was another part of it, and I just read the first part, and
I thought I sent it all to. I didn't do it. I left it right. but I thought my competent helper sent you everything.
Probably did. Okay. So we'll leave that blank then until we get next meeting. Okay. Now. Well, you guys, which one should I pick up here? Where for?
Wages for health officer.
Oh, that was going to be zero. Oh yeah, there we are. Okay. Zero there. Wages for health officer. Health officer expense, let's just say 50.
Okay.
Since we haven't used any. Wouldn't it be humane? The contract's for $300 and something. They asked for $500. I'd say we put this $500, pay the contract, and whatever else is there is.
We just do like we've been doing.
Yeah.
Just
yeah.
Continue to put
pay
it in.
Pay out of that, and then whatever's left over, we pay them at the end.
Yes.
Of the
year. Right.
Yes.
Do that at the end of the year. Yes.
Okay.
That's my thought.
I'd agree with you.
Sure.
Okay.
Yep.
Animal control officer expenses. Well, since there haven't been any expenses,
I think you should leave something in.
Yeah, let's put let's leave 50.
Yeah.
You know, they, I had to have this very large German Shepherd riding shotgun with me on the way down, and had that dog wanted to stop someplace for something to eat, I wasn't about.
Well, you might have to bury chickens or something someday too. Don't forget. So.
So. Okay.
New pair of sneakers so you can keep running faster than one.
Yeah. Okay. Fire protection.
Would anybody think about maybe entertaining that being 50,000 instead of 51,000? Slight increase and.
Well,
I think if we wait on that figure for another week, I think all will be made clear.
Okay.
And I think everyone's going to be happy. That's my prediction.
Okay.
All right.
I don't think we have to fill in that number right there, but the LTC is a pass-through. Okay. And then all those pass-throughs under emergency management. Looks like we can just turn the page.
I think we're going to finalize this tonight.
Whoa! Oh, not at all.
As long as it's not snowing.
Voice collection, that looks.
That could go up with.
Collecting waste.
With this new recycling program, we may find more stuff beside the road. If that's what that refers to.
Well, it's for that and for the dumpster for the private garage.
Yeah. I suspect that could be significantly more with the new recycling. You may find more and more stuff thrown on back roads, unfortunately.
How about we keep it at 1,000 and see how it goes?
Plays out, yeah. I'd agree with that.
You okay with that?
Yeah, I just think we're going to see an increase, but yeah, we haven't used it all other than one year anyway.
Right. Okay, health and welfare. The Social Services Advisory Committee is coming next week to talk with us about this.
Didn't we meet with them once already?
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
They want to come.
What are they coming for this time?
Maybe provide some of the information that we asked for.
Okay.
So I would. So let's leave that blank. That's what I would suggest right now.
So the current budget numbers. Are these coming from their request?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Yes. So this is their. The requests that they put in.
Okay.
So is it okay if I leave it in there for now, or just...
Yeah, you could.
Okay.
What do you want to do? Leave it in?
Well, that way I know what they're, how they're breaking it up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
If that's okay.
Helpful. Yeah.
That all right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Cemeteries. Okay. Does that... They wanted $1,000 right. more than the lawn care.
They did, that's right.
And I wasn't sure if that meant they needed $1,000 more than the $3,000 we budgeted last year, or just $1,000 more than what the cemetery lawnmower.
I think the letter said
$1,000 more,
more than the lawnmower.
Yeah, right.
So we'll come back to that one.
Yeah.
Okay. The rec board. The rec board, what was, they were asking, oh, the rec board. I was getting it, going down to the community center. The recreation board came, they had a good presentation last week. Seems like they're doing a great job. I would put that, just speaking for myself, down to 1,200. They're requesting 2,000.
I wasn't here for that meeting, but I would put it down to 1,000 and just level fund it.
They were, some highlights were they're trying to get a program together at the school for, they need to buy snowshoes because they want to have snowshoeing for adults at the school. They want to put a little, I'll call it an Anthoneum, or, but a little building at the school.
Sort of like you have at the pit now.
Sort of like that. Like we could have carried that roof up there. That's right, too. But so they had a gathering place. That was something. I'm trying to think of things that programs that they were talking about for adults, because still a lot of their programs.
Yeah.
Outside volleyball.
Adult volleyball, yeah.
And they're talking about, I guess, Ultimate Frisbee.
Yes, that's right.
Talking about plans for a...
They actually had a good presentation, but I
believe.
But it's just, I mean...
And they do have some fundraising plans, too.
Right.
So.
Did you say 1,500 you want to load it to?
Well, I would say 12.
And they charge for everything they do. I mean, all the kids pay for their sports and stuff, so.
Well, whereas we've had some concerns, I think, maybe in the past about their, you know, how are they were presenting bills and that sort of thing. I'm really encouraged by the direction of the rec board. I think they've listened to some of the concerns and, you know, my hope would be that we could, you know, leave it there. You know, it sounds like I may not prevail on this one, but I certainly
give it your best shot.
I certainly would not like to see it reduced to $1,000.
1,500 maybe, I'd be pretty comfortable with it, but
I think they made a very good case, and I had a lot of confidence in what they were attempting to do, so I would be in favor of their request.
Okay, we have two people at keeping the request. One at 15, one at 1,200, and one at 1,000.
Well, I think I don't want to put it at 2,000. I'll say that right now.
Yeah.
I really don't. I mean, I think do fundraising. I think there's a lot of different ways to do it. You know, they do collect money from each kid that, you know, participates. They've grown their account pretty well. So, I mean, they can make the money to do a lot of this stuff. And I'd go with Zeke at the 1,200 if anybody wants to come down from 15 to 12.
From 2?
That's why I didn't say anybody. 2 to 12. 15 to 12 isn't that bad. And with the budget the way it is, and, you know.
Yeah, I guess I could support that. And that still gives them a modest increase, I guess, so. Over the 1,000.
I was hoping, Steve, you were going to stay at 1,500.
What we pencil it in, and then we see what the final figures look
right.
like, and we look at it again.
And it can go up. I mean,
this is still preliminary. This
I
isn't.
I think the final figures are not going to be pretty.
Yes,
and
that's why I'm not thinking.
That's why I'd rather be on the stingy side of things now. That we, you know, because it isn't going to be pretty. So I would say we pencil in 1,200 and see where it goes from. Because what's going to end up happening is we're going to see a budget worse than the 10% there, and then we're going to have to come back and we're going to have to go through all these again and start knocking them down. Because we're just, I mean, you will have people in here telling us there's no way they're going to accept that big of an increase. So why not get it down as low as we can get it now, so those numbers, we're not fighting to get them down even more. So I would say 12 and be ready to drop.
I'm thinking 12 and let's see if we can hold it at 12 and not cut it further than that.
Right. Like I say, it'd be great. It would be great to be able to give everybody all they ask for.
Sure.
It really would. I mean, they all really deserve to.
Everybody deserves it, yeah, and they are working hard.
They do a good job.
But it is still a lot of just. I keep going back. It's the Dummerston Rec Board. It's for everybody, and they do certainly concentrate on the school program.
Oh, but it sounds like, I wasn't at that meeting, but I've heard of the different.
They're
things.
Trying.
It's a good board, and I think they.
It
are
is a
trying,
good board.
They are trying to do different things.
Right. So I guess I'll. Yeah, I'm sorry, Joe. If I'd known you'd work with me, I'd have stayed at 15.
If we do go with 15, then at least we'd have something we could cut if we had to. If we go with 12,
Well, that's what we'd rather not have to cut anything.
Well, we're going to be making another pass at this thing, when the bottom line hits.
All right. That's exactly. So that's why. Well, we got 3. That's at 12. So.
Well, I just think we should give a better sign of encouragement to this new board.
That's why I'm increasing it instead of just level funding it.
Mm-hmm.
In the situation we're in, to increase it over last year, except the policing is the only thing that I think of. Well, wages, but I'm not. So, to increase it by the 200, I think is
think of the percentage wise of that.
Sign.
I mean, they're talking 100% increase,
mm-hmm.
and you went up 20%.
So yeah, I'm mindful of that.
Mm-hmm. If you want to look at percentages, I mean,
yeah. I was impressed with them. I'd like to encourage them. So rather than just level fund them or mm-hmm. cut, what we gave them last year, I put $1,200 in and see how everything looks when we get done.
Right. Well, it gets back to this question of user fees. I mean, they can always charge more for their programs.
Yeah, they don't charge much for the programs. Yeah. I mean, they're pretty cost effective. They minimize it.
But then you go think, well, how much does that hamper the people that can't afford even that increase?
Well, they do have scholarships for it,
right.
And there's different avenues
through the school lunch program. Anybody
right.
gets reduced right. lunches gets free. They do have several scholarship or grant programs.
Glaybeck Contracting could buy T-shirts for the Scott Farm.
Maybe I'd consider an adult program. I might.
Okay, 1,200.
I think we lost this one, Guru.
It's
not
losing.
It's not losing.
We'll look at it again.
No, you lost. I feel the same way about the sheriff and the police. We lose.
1,200. All right. Community center. Their letter says they wanted just the.
The painting.
Yeah.
That's 11,000 something, I believe, was the one estimate they got.
Mm-hmm.
11,000. What? I don't think it was.
Yeah,
even.
It's in the budget
folder. Yeah. And the budget folder is this red one. Okay.
Did we get the cemeteries, Laurie, or is that something
else? Well, I think I'm going to have to figure it out.
Okay.
This last fiscal year, we expended $2,015 on cemetery mowing.
Mm-hmm.
but that's going to increase
right.
with this new contract.
Right.
So I'll have it for the
next meeting. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Community Center is not asking for any additional budget requests for 2015.
There.
But this, does that still mean that they're requesting the $4,000 that they've been getting, or that they are getting this fiscal year?
Can I see that letter, Zeke?
Yeah.
Because there's also the letter, the...
They do say the painting.
Yeah, see, it says no additional money. So I think that's the... well, I guess that's a phone call to Lester. Lester was just here.
Yeah.
Right, because part of that $4,000 was actually for repairing the door.
Yes.
So
our concern is, are they asking for the $4,000 that we gave them last year plus the painting, or are they asking for zero and then
and
the
painting? Right.
Or are they asking for the $2,000, which used to be the...
Right.
Yeah, let's find out what they're actually asking for.
I mean, no increase would be $4,000 last year, so...
And my question is, shouldn't things like painting and the roof and even the doors from last year, shouldn't that be included in the capital fund like we do for the roof for this building?
Something like the painting, I would think so, if we wanted to do the whole schmear at once, or if we
do a side of year or
do
something.
Part of it. This year, part of it next year.
Yeah, that's, I mean, that's just not very efficient, though, obviously, when you're there with the equipment.
That's how I do it.
And it's,
no,
it
you
is
did almost two sides this year.
And it is in pretty bad shape.
Yeah,
it does. It really does.
But if you're going to rent a lift, you know, it's
right.
cheaper
it's
to just...
It's going to cost you, yeah, it's going to cost you more.
More
to
if you
equipment.
Do it over 4 years and just rent it for one shot. But
yeah,
I guess we need to know what the exact number is that they're looking
right.
for. But Lori's right. I mean, something that big should be through a capital fund expenditure. But we don't have time to build up the capital between now and next year. So,
what do you mean?
We don't have the money sitting in the capital fund now.
Well,
to paint.
Do we?
Hold on. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I don't have the capital fund. I think we might.
Yeah, I think we might.
Jeez.
And then that's raising that number that we have to...
We may want to bump up the capital,
right.
but the money, I think, is...
Is there.
Yeah.
The money is there.
Okay, thank you.
What about putting...
So we just need to know exactly what it is they're asking for.
Right.
Yeah.
Is it 15? Is it 15,700 or is it 11,700?
Yes. And,
the other thing is that
we want to get bids.
It has to go out to bid
yeah.
when
yes.
it's that high.
Oh, right.
So, but that we could use as a ballpark.
Mm-hmm.
So we can look at the capital budget again. We could possibly have this as an article.
I was going to suggest that.
And put it out to a vote at the town meeting.
Put it out to a vote for it to come out of the capital
yeah,
fund, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. So for this...
That's not something the select board can decide?
The select board can decide. They can include it in their budget.
Yep. In the capital budget or not?
Yes, they can. Or they can... choose to put it as a separate article so that it's voted on separately at town meeting.
That way everybody has input at town meeting rather than just our...
Looking at our regular budget and saying, mm-hmm. no, we're not going to accept it. It gives them an opportunity to speak on it on that particular...
Right, mm-hmm. instead of saying, why is your budget up 10%?
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So,
thanks, Lori.
10%. Yep. All right, so... We'll check and find out what...
Do you want me to contact Buster?
Sure.
Okay.
The library, asking for $12,000. Again, we budgeted $10,000 last year, and they...
In 2014, we budgeted $10,000, and they bumped it up to $12,000.
They took
right,
it to
right.
$10,000.
And then we
yeah.
did $12,000.
And then we did $12,000 last
yep.
year.
Mm-hmm. Right? And...
And I'd say we leave it at $12,000
mm-hmm.
or $11,999.
Okay. They give us a request or not?
That was a
yes.
request.
Yes.
Right.
Yep. Mm-hmm. That good with everyone?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Good with which trigger?
What?
12,000.
12,000.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm good with that.
Yes. Northern Vermont rural. What is it? The back roads.
No,
this is actually Lori, right? This is the RFP, right? The fire hydrants.
Yeah, it used to be the George Aiken
right.
Conservation District, and they've changed their name
okay.
to this.
All right, and they do.
They give grants for fire hydrants.
Okay,
that's one of the things, and they work with Better Back Roads or
okay.
did.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I think, oh boy, it's in there. Did we have seven in Dummerston that they have like five that they've contributed grant money to?
Mm-hmm.
And they usually give like $3,000 to $4,000 for doing hydrants.
Right.
It's well
so
worth $100.
It's well worth $100. So this year they put one in. We put one in over at Bunker Farm.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was a $4,200 grant or something.
Okay. Conservation Commission, I would suggest we level fund that one.
At 750?
Yeah.
Do you remember why we went from 850 down to 750 last year? Was that because they didn't give us a request?
I think you were just trying to save money.
Okay.
Yeah, I'd have to go back and look at my notes, but...
Energy Committee, I'd level fund.
Yeah,
and
I
both,
agree with
both of these groups are
do a great
raising money on there.
They do a good job, too.
Yeah.
I mean, they really...
I still wish the Energy Committee would consider working on this trash program to see if there's not a more efficient way for us to get household pickup, or working on the school on buses.
You know, I could just dump my trash off in your barrels. Would I?
I've been dropping it at your place.
Oh,
it's usually real light with your bags. Those grain bags hold quite a bit when you stuff it down in here.
That's why I'm getting most extra charges. Okay, Farmland Protection Fund.
Level fund it, 25. Anybody else?
I think that's good.
Mm-hmm. Conservation. Okay.
I like that we've encouraged them to get donations.
Right. And they did have their farm day in August.
Yeah.
They raised a little money. Actually, the Conservation Commission helped them with that. Let's see. The Windham County Historical Society has traditionally gotten $250.
I'd say we keep giving that to them.
The county tax. I don't have a figure for that. They had their preliminary hearing, or their public hearing on a draft budget yesterday. It's going to go up. Their person that would have tallied all the numbers wasn't there, and I didn't have time to tally everything up. I believe it's going to go up from what that is. It's funding, increasing funding for the trainings for the sheriff's department, you know, the maintenance of the sheriff department's building, maintenance, the courthouse, the side judges, the personnel there. They'll have another meeting in January, I think, or yeah, and I'll go to that. You know, surprisingly, I was the only member of the public to be be at that meeting yesterday.
That's historically always been the case, that Dummerston has been the only one represented. Which is crazy for such a large budget.
Yeah, yeah. So we have to leave that blank. I'll try to go through their figures and see if I can come up with at least a ballpark figure of what they're thinking of. Memorial Day?
150.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay. Miscellaneous?
Space spent, $25.
How can you believe it?
What do you think that number should be, Laurie?
I think it should be zero.
Zero. I like it.
Okay. All right. Well, that was
bank service charges?
Zero.
Zero. All right. That wasn't so painful.
So I'll make all these changes in the three different files and I'll send them out to you.
Sure, sure, good.
Yeah, that would be great. Okay.
Oh, I'm glad we didn't go into that tonight. As long as it's raining and not snowing out there, we'll be okay.
Gosh, I think the sun is coming out,
yeah.
Actually.
Yeah, let's hope so.
Okay, so, that's good. New business. The zoning administrator's term is up.
Oh, thank goodness. Oh!
She would like to be reappointed.
I'll make a motion to reappoint Charlotte as the zoning administrator for
another
3 years.
I'll second that, okay. Any discussion? All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Charlotte Panis has been reappointed our zoning administrator. Would you like me to contact her?
I can call across the room tomorrow morning.
Oh, all right.
Let's do it that way.
All right, okay. And then the a certificate of change for the grand list. This has to do with change in state classification of the Comcast and Southern Vermont Cable property or...
Cables.
I'll make a motion that we sign the certificate of change to the 2014 grand list.
Second.
Any discussion? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All right. Okay. any other business? Do you have anything in the other business?
Yeah, I wish you would direct Lori to get me a subscription to this pretty soon.
I wish you would too, then I could do it.
Then I could leave her alone.
I'll make a motion that we have Lori get Steve a...
his own personal copy.
His own personal copy sent to his house at whatever his address is.
Don't give it out publicly.
Right. But his phone number is... Nobody wants to
second. Can I second that motion?
Well, I don't know if you should recuse yourself.
Oh, yeah, probably I should recuse myself. Yeah.
So this is the lines of lack of a second.
I'll second the motion. All right. Any further, any discussion? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'll recuse myself, so.
Okay.
I only heard two votes.
Yeah,
me too.
See, we all know you don't know how to use the computer. We know who does all your work. All
right. I'll vote an aye.
I can't believe you guys said that made me wait 8 months to get this.
Well, you know, if we waited a little longer, we, you know, how, when's your term up?
What a ways yet.
Oh. All right. Any other business?
You didn't have a final vote, did you?
I think we had three and one abstention.
No, you didn't call for the nays.
Oh, the nays. All right.
Opposed.
Those opposed.
Nay.
Okay, one nay. Thank you for setting me straight. And one
abstention.
Abstention.
One abstention, yeah, I have that. Thank you.
Okay.
They used to mail that all the time.
I know. I don't know why they don't mail it to us anyway.
They're
just
cutting costs. That's
know.
Their excuse.
Their budget, you know.
I just don't sit at the computer long enough to read something like that. So.
All right, so. Any other business? Did I say that? If not, I will entertain the motion.
Move we adjourn.
Second
that motion.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you very much.
Our meeting.